Hey, hello guys, welcome to the another lecture series on electric charges and the electric field. In today's video, we're going to discuss about electric flux and also a very, very important law associated with it, which is nothing but Gauss law in electrostatics. All right, so if you haven't checked the previous videos, I'll leave the link in the description. Kindly watch that so that you have a continuation. Fine, so let's get started. The first topic that we're going to discuss is about electric flux. Right, so electric flux. So what is electric flux? Let's define that first. It is the total number of electrical field lines passing normally through an area. Normally means what? Perpendicular to this area. Okay, number of electrical field lines passing normally through an area. Through an area held in the region of electric field. All right. So let's try to understand with a diagram. Let us say I have a plane, okay, a plane inclined like that. Now, just to make it visualize thoroughly, I'm just drawing the plane on which this is inclined. Okay, hope you are able to visualize this. That's a horizontal plane. On that, I have another plane which is inclined, let us say at an angle theta here, or some angle alpha. Okay, now I have an electrical field going from left to right, so let me draw that also. Let's say I have electrical field lines going from left to right. Okay, and all right, so these are my electrical field lines that are passing through this area. There are n number of electrical field lines. Okay, I'm not drawing all of them, but I've just drawn few lines here just to indicate the electrical field lines are passing through this area. Now, electrical flux is what? Number of electrical field lines passing perpendicular to the area, right? Perpendicular to the area. Now, let me draw a perpendicular line to this area. To this area, if I draw a perpendicular line, that is the perpendicular line drawn to this area. So now let us say the angle between the electrical field, angle between the electrical field and a perpendicular line drawn to this area. Let me just highlight that area. So that's my area. Okay, that's my area. To that I have drawn a perpendicular line. Okay, to that I have drawn a perpendicular line. And the angle made by the normal or the perpendicular line that I have drawn to this area, the angle between the perpendicular line drawn to the area and the electrical field, let us say that is theta. Okay. Now, if you resolve this electrical field into two component, okay, so you will get electrical field, the component of electrical field along the normal is E cos theta. Now, how do I know that? Whichever side angle is there, that side cos will come. Easy to understand, easy to resolve. For example, if you have a vector F, okay, making an angle theta with respect to, let's say, this x-axis. Then if I want to know what is the component of this F, that will be F cos theta here. So whichever side angle is there, that side cos will come and the other side sine will come. Just remember that, that's easy. Okay? So I resolve this electrical field into two component. I'll get E cos theta as the component of electrical field perpendicular to this area. And parallel to this area, if you resolve that electrical field, in this direction, you will have the component of the electrical field as E sine theta. Now, E sine theta is not passing through the area. It is grazing the surface. Correct, no? It is not passing through the area. E sine theta is not passing through the area. What is passing through the area? E cos theta. So, at this point, the electrical field perpendicular to this area is E cos theta. Then, throughout the region, I want to know how much is the total electrical flux passing perpendicular to the area. Right? So, then what I am going to do, multiply with the total area of the plane. Because E cos theta multiplied by the total area will give you total number of electrical field lines passing through the entire area. That is what is your electrical flux, right? So therefore mathematically the electrical flux, we write electrical flux is represented by the symbol, it's phi, P पी एच आई, पाई इज दिस, ठीक है, पी आई पाई इज दिस, पी एच आई फाई इज दिस सिंबल, ठीक है, पुट अ सर्कल एंड देन वर्टिकल लाइन, राइट. सो नाउ इलेक्ट्रिकल फ्लक्स, आई एम राइटिंग इट एज फाई सफिक्स ई, विच मीन्स इट्स इलेक्ट्रिकल फ्लक्स. सो इलेक्ट्रिकल फ्लक्स नाउ कैन बी रिटन एज ई कॉस थीटा, ई कॉस थीटा मल्टीप्लाइड बाई द एरिया ऑफ द प्लेन, बिकॉज ई कॉस थीटा इज द स्मॉल इलेक्ट्रिकल फील्ड at this point perpendicular to the area. Throughout the area I want to know how much is the total number of electrical field lines passing perpendicular to the area. So everywhere you can resolve the electrical field, e cos theta will be the perpendicular to the plane, right? So that is normal to the plane, and then multiply that with the area, that's it, okay? And now this can be written as e vector dot a vector, because when you expand e vector dot a vector you will get it as what, e a cos theta, as simple as that. All right, so the electrical flux mathematically is E vector dot A vector. Very, very important. Now, is it a scalar quantity or a vector quantity? Let's also write that. It is a scalar quantity. Why am I calling it as a scalar quantity? See, the dot product of two vector will always give you scalar. Cross product of two vector gives you vector. But here it's a dot product, E vector dot A vector. So that's a scalar quantity. And what is its unit? Yeah, its unit is, we know the unit of electrical field, which is Newton per Coulomb, and along with that the meter square is getting multiplied, because unit of area is meter square. So it is Newton meter square per Coulomb, okay? So that is the unit of electric flux. All right, now let us take some special cases, okay? So what will happen to electrical flux when theta is 0 or 180, okay? And then what will happen to the electrical flux when theta is 90? All these cases we will discuss now. All those things are very important, because we will be making use of this concept, electric flux, E vector dot A vector, whatever we have written, we'll be making use of this in the application of Gauss law. Okay, we're going to discuss something called Gauss law. There we're going to make use of this. See, the same formula can also be written like this. One more thing I just wanted to make you understand is, suppose I consider a small area here. Okay, I consider a small area. Throughout the area, I'll just multiply it E vector dot A vector, right? I can also write that electrical flux as the integration of E vector dot dA vector. E vector dot dA vector. E vector dot dA vector means what? I'll consider a small area here. Okay, small area, and area of that is dA. Area of that is dA. So E vector dot dA vector, when you do, you will get E cos theta into dA. That means E cos theta into the small area through which the electrical field line E cos theta is passing through. Then integration means what? Summation. So like that, if I find out everywhere on entire region area can be divided into small, 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 small area dA, and everywhere you find out E cos theta into dA, then you add all of them. That is the meaning of this integration. Okay, electrical flux can also be written as integration of E vector dot dA vector, and it is throughout the area you have to add E vector dot dA vector. Everywhere you're going to find out E vector dot dA vector, that is E dA cos theta, and then you add all of them. That will give you anyway E vector dot dA vector only you will get back. Okay, so somewhere sometimes it's also written like that. I'm just making you aware of this thing. Okay, right. So now we'll take the special cases. Special case, if theta equal to 0, okay, if theta equal to 0, then all the electrical field lines will be going perpendicular to the area itself. Theta becomes 0 means what? This plane will become vertical. Then all the electrical field lines, if this is a plane which is standing vertical, all the electrical field lines are going perpendicular to the area already, okay, then cos 0 is what? 1. So the flux will be maximum. Then the flux is going to be E into A into cos 0, okay? So what is cos 0? Cos 0 is 1. So the flux is going to be maximum, E into A itself is the flux. All right, that is your flux. And how would the diagram will look like? So the diagram is going to look like this. So you have this plane which is standing vertical, and then you have electrical field lines passing through it. Yeah, so that is your electrical field and that's your area. Okay, and that's your area. So electrical field is just E. So E into A will be the electric flux in this case, right? And now, suppose if theta is 90, okay? If theta equal to 90, then the flux is what? EA cos 90. EA cos 90. Cos 90 is what? 0. Right? So the electrical flux becomes 0 if theta is 90. So how the diagram will look like? The plane will become parallel to the electrical field. Right? So it's going to be like this. So that is your plane. And the electrical field lines are just grazing the surface and going. No electrical field lines are passing through the area. They are just grazing the surface and going. Correct, no? So there are no electrical field lines that are passing through it. That's it. So that's your area. So here, the angle between area vector, if you take area vector, or in other words, if you draw a normal to this area, so the normal is vertical and electrical field is horizontal. So the angle between normal and the electrical field is 90 degree in this case, right? This is your electric field. This is your area direction. Now I have written here E vector dot A vector. You might be wondering, area is not a vector, yaar. Area is a scalar quantity. Why are you writing it as A vector? See, area is a scalar. I agree with that. But we associate a direction to it. Okay? So we give a direction to it. So the direction of area vector is what? Perpendicular to the plane. Normal to the plane, in other words. Okay? Area is multiplied with a unit vector perpendicular to the area. So area into the unit vector perpendicular to the area becomes area vector. Okay? So that is what I've written here. E vector dot A vector means that. Okay? A vector is nothing but the direction of A vector is perpendicular to the area. All right. So now, since that we have discussed what is electric flux, and when the electric flux is zero, when the electric flux is maximum, now we will discuss very important law called as Gauss law. Okay? So Gauss law in electrostatics. Gauss law in electrostatics. Why am I specifically writing Gauss law in electrostatics? Because there is something called Gauss law even in magnetism. Okay, so that's why I am not just writing simply as Gauss law. I am writing specifically Gauss law in electrostatics. All right. So the statement of Gauss law, let us first write, and then I'll explain you what exactly the meaning of this. So it says that, it states that the total electrical flux through a closed surface is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge present within the closed surface, right? As a statement. So that is, mathematically if I write, the net flux is equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge present within the closed surface, it seems. Now let us try to understand what is the meaning of this, right? Now let us take a closed surface. Closed surface means what? It's like a sphere. Okay? It's not necessarily, it has to be a sphere. Any surface. Okay? So even you can take a inflated balloon, but you tie the mouth. Okay? And then you go inside. It is not spherical in shape, or it's not in any proper shape, but still everywhere there is a surface. So it's like you enclose yourself with a surface. That becomes a closer surface, right? So let us take a sphere, right? So that's my sphere here. Let me also Alright, so that is my sphere. within the sphere, let us say we have charge Q1 here and another charge minus Q2 here, and say another charge Q3 here, and outside the sphere let us say we have a charge Q4 here and another charge minus Q5 here. Alright, and now let us try to apply the Gauss law for this sphere. Now we will consider a small area here. Okay, a small area, and through this let us say the electrical field due to all the charges, electrical field due to all the charges that is present within the closed sphere or within the closed surface and the outside the closed surface, electrical field due to all the charges in the vicinity put together is E. Okay, and the area of this small region that I have taken, let us say the area of this region is dA. dA is the area, and the normal drawing, normal if I draw to that area, that is your normal direction, okay, or direction of dA you can say. The angle between them is theta, let's take like that, okay. Then how much will be the small electrical flux there? The small electrical flux will be, the small electrical flux here will be E dA cos theta, correct? Or I can write it as E vector dot dA vector. Okay, that is your small electrical flux. The small electrical flux through this region. Okay, small electrical flux through this region is E vector dot dA vector. Now I want to know the total flux through the entire surface. Okay, total electrical flux through the entire surface. Then what I should do? Integration. Okay, so therefore the net flux is nothing but integration of E vector dot dA vector, and I am just going to put a circle here indicating that it is a closed integral. Closed integral means you have a closed surface. At everywhere on the surface, everywhere you are going to find out E vector dot dA vector and keep adding all such E vector dot dA vector throughout the closed surface. Okay, so that's the meaning of closed integral. You might see here, I have written it as, let me rewrite it, integration symbol, and then you put a circle here just to indicate it is a closed surface. And this is a net flux. And this net flux is always equal to what it seems. Look at the statement. It is always equal to 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge present within the closed surface. Be very careful. It is net charge present within the closed surface. So I can write this as 1 by epsilon naught times. What is the total charge present within the closed surface? I have Q1. All right. Plus Q2 is what? Minus Q2. So minus Q2. And then plus Q3. Net charge means I will keep adding all the charges, negative charges written as it is. Like Q1 plus minus Q2 will become plus into minus is minus, so Q1 minus Q2, and the third charge is Q3. I am not considering the charge which are present outside the closed sphere or closed surface. So it is always equal to 1 by epsilon naught times, the total flux is always equal to 1 by epsilon times the net charge present within the closed surface alone. You are not going to consider the charges present outside the closed surface. So that is your Gauss law statement. Okay? This is your Gauss law statement and the formula. Very, very important. We are going to make use of this a lot of times. Okay. So if you don't want to remember this formula, you can remember this. That is enough. Okay. Remembering this itself is enough. Right. Now, based on this Gauss law, varieties of problems can be asked. Okay. And there are a lot of applications also on this Gauss law, which we will gradually take up in the upcoming videos. And for today's video, I will also include a small another topic in this. One important note: if the net charge is equal to zero, then the total flux is also zero. Very simple to understand, right? If the net charge is zero, means what? You take let us say this Q1 and Q2 are equal in magnitude but opposite in sign. Okay, then Q1 minus Q2 will cancel out each other. If Q1 and Q2 both are equal in magnitude and they're opposite in sign, they will cancel out each other like a dipole. Okay, that's what I'm going to write next. If a surface encloses, if a closed surface encloses dipole. If a closed surface encloses a dipole, then net flux through through the surface is zero. Why? Because I know that net flux is 1 by epsilon naught times the net charge. Okay. Now if I consider a dipole, dipole means what? Two equal and opposite charges, they will cancel out each other. No? Plus Q if I have here, then I will have minus Q. These two are separated by a small distance, that is your dipole. So if a closed surface has a dipole with a net, then the net charge is zero. Okay. So the Q net will become zero. So 1 by epsilon naught times is zero. Right? So your net flux will become zero. Remember that. So whenever a closed surface encloses a dipole, then the net flux through the surface is zero. Very simple reason, because net charge is zero. Alright, so that's all for this video. We will continue the rest of the things in the next video. In the next video, we're going to discuss about application of Gauss law and also some important problems on Gauss law. Alright, so till then, stay tuned and have happy learning. Thank you all. Bye-bye.